refresher, a little bit new. I hope it's full. So the slide, ecosystem. Digital payments, it is some merchant taking out your digital, there's a whole lot of stuff that goes. For instance, you have payment bank, corporate banks, your financial, and you have providers, you have this side, the customers, do they have banking card, wallets, banking, they bank at micro ATM, and then you have the issuing bank and the payment and so on. So there is a that goes, that is digital payments, so basically the commerce. I'm going to go in the next few minutes through digital payments, basic challenges, tax vulnerabilities, then focus on some of the aspects. So this slide, you look at 1950s to 60s, where debit cards came in through 90s. This instrument started coming. Bitcoin was first. You may be familiar with Bitcoin after class. In terms of the alternate form of Bitcoin is which has come up. Behind Bitcoin is anybody?
Blockchain
and block. It's a immutable. What does that mean? What is immutable?
Transaction cannot be reversed.
When the record exists, and you cannot make transaction has happened, so it is immutable. Because anybody can devise it a ledger. So basically the ledger and debit the transaction. So that's the, and with the have new forms of these which didn't exist, we'll bring this went through Bitcoin. Am I right? So I'll be talking things. Before I start, is money. We look into the nature of it, what is the payment system, variable properties of money, requirements, what banks do, and what all the other things that I so we think about the buyer and first you need to think about more than you need to think about the bank and the seller's bank. You have fees and the parties. The services when you have banks, etc. This slide, and you have the seller here, banks that are coming into the picture, and there's an access which the instruct the bank does, and on the other side, access point, which is with. So basically, info being transferred, which essentially makes it electronic. So this is the basis of monetary transactions all across the world. Here you have something called, which is essentially banking system. So I had a check today. And it means that during and in addition to that, of course, that you have the money in your account, going on, we come to that shortly. Things that are going on in the claim process, and as you can see, right, so that takes us to, so ultimately, we have. Which is where that ecosystem needs to be in place for any digital payment. So, the definition is generally accepted as a means of payment. If you look at three, if you look at monetary history, it started off with barter. Barter means a direct step. So, suppose I grow, I want to. Why the horse basically water. So the problem is game. Because there is a limited number of horse, limited number of people. But how and that's when the fish came to being. It could be arrow or it could be etc. etc. So if we thought 1,000 years this is long before we found certain way rarer than other. Gold and silver, or take the example of diamond, they refine that greater value. They refine, they have to be, the diamond has to be cut, it takes on a certain good medium of exchange. Because at the gold, once, for example, all of you have heard of Bola, it's the deepest gold mine, is no gold anymore. It's a resource, and as people take it out, the gold that you can mine is more. And that being, the currency came into being, the point that paper would be with assumptions that if you wanted, they could exchange the paper for equivalent amount of gold. So that's why you find the world has kept, which is a currency that is being circulated in the nation. So, to get to this level, this is where you cannot mattress at some point under your mattress. So that's where, and once you have a bank account, then as I mentioned to you earlier, the transfer of information, are materialized schemes, so it's a transfer of money information. So let's take a barter, so direct exchange of services. The problem is, I have a double points in it. What exactly does that mean? Create, let's say you have your account. So, name Deepika. Any Deepika here? No Deepika. So, Deepika bought a cow and run. No? So, Deepika, the cow, run the bicycle. That is the fundamental. Assuming that Deepika has a cow, he must have a cow and wants. This is clearly a one time. Deepika is not going to want a cow. Once she has a cow, Ranveer does not want to have.
Yep.
They both are married. Even so, but needs do not exist. So this is and continuing between them, but at some part of time, I'm fed up of this, I don't expect. So, now, the interesting thing is going to be after discovery of works. For example of a partner. Yeah, even because it's a slight variant. You are auction side. A person who wants something will bid for it. A person put it up on the website. The discovery was obviously not before the internet came in. Now, what are that this issue? So, promote barter. You have a barter, particularly as you said, if the Deepika will say to him. That's where Deepika and Ranveer are fine. And literally no connection. They do not know their friends. What to do? The problem. So Deepika, so that's the problem that Deepika wants to buy. And she is willing to pass that bicycle. She is willing to buy. So she sends Ranveer 5 for the bicycle. So what is
the middle man?
Right, so the middle woman. So basically that is, so you have a trust. Deepika would say 5,000 rupees to that middle woman, and verification that the bicycle is acquired at doorstep, you don't pay. And Ranveer knows a middle woman and knows he or she is trustworthy, right? I can send you the bicycle. That requires a which interest only after eBay started realizing that this was people started. And that actually PayPal as the entity for the school. Now the problem at the monetary and tax system, and government wants to, for good or for bad, everybody knows my government wants to tax. Yeah, so there are, you can get electrical, it's basically in the service of citizens, they have, and for that figure out what, work through it. Without going through these things, you are essentially bypassing the secret tax system. Case when money is not returned, so it is another story. So what we are looking at is fiat money, the legal tender. If you are familiar with fiat money, it's legal tender, 100 rupees. What is the guarantee that I'll do this? So if you look at it or 200 or whatever, what is it that strikes you? Can't hear you. I promise to. So I promise to pay the 1,000 rupees, and it is signed by. Sorry. And the RBI. So the RBI from that basically gives it clarity. So basically, you can the Bank of India, they will pay the fees next in terms of gold or whatever. So the equivalent. If we take a small divergence, you see which characterizes the. That is of course the first thing. What is that is an anti-fraud characteristic. What else do you see? What else? Does anybody see a number? So that number is the same number. And which makes you maybe newer 2000. So legal tender is. So that's how money is issued by a central government, it cannot be refused. Digital money which is not legal tender, not issued by a central government, could be issued by travelers, checks, gifts, then you have token money which is represented by token money or funny money, like might you get some token. They are rolling out, let's say, you can use it, it's not valid anywhere, you can go from stall to stall and rotational money, even flyer miles. Recognition, say call it, telephone card. Classic legal status, some of these basically from Reserve Bank of India. Some of these are basically banking, basically to transfer information. To put everything, see ultimately is form of a money matrix. Cash, government banks, account with government checks. Travelers check, certified miles, personal check, gifts. Now, some statistics in the US, it is known as M0, M1, sorry, M1, M0 and M3 and so on. 660, M1 is 28 billion, which all this is cash, money. That amount not exactly cash, but equal. Interest deposits, essentially, also they're not. These two are basically money, that any type of payment, and the total of about you have the other. So fine, that is not ready money. It's wait till the CD may be here and you have to be right. CDs are for a year. So that's not liquid. Combination of $6 trillion. Everything together. So it's scaling billion, few hundred, what is available to money. So when we get to the banking system, obviously local banks is not sufficient. Money transfers all over the world. You need transactions with, so they are involved with, will be under the bank, which is Basel in the Swiss port, part of it is known as the world. That connects privately owned banks, fixed ownership banks, and so on. And within countries, the World Fund are not actually part of the ecosystem, involved with two nation states. So, for this is a public policy lender. Can anyone give me? IMF has lent money for some youth. Any example? You heard of IMF, right? So, when you have massive projects going on, can you give me an example?
Highways.
For example, highway, yes, you have huge amount of money, but then, which are going to be a massive environmental cleanup. Search, and then, of course, the country. Similarly, in cases, agent, which, large organizations. All large projects. So when Lebanon going, and the money was coming into the and the World Bank. So that is the World Banking System. And now if we get much closer to your transactions, we are looking at you as a client and a merchant. So you want something that the merchant has, so the merchant offers you something, and you basically pay the merchant. But there are a huge bunch, there are a large number of things that are also going on in the background, which the client never realize. The merchant has to check, has to basically collect money from an acquiring bank. The acquiring bank has to get money from the issuing bank, which has to debit money from the client. Then there's an interbank clearing settlement network, and there's a bank card scheme. And all of this has to go on through the post-authorization. So when you present your credit card or debit card, it has to be authorized first, right? And what happens for something to be authorized when you go to a merchant?
Pin,
right. So first of all, you take out your credit card and debit card, so you have a physical entity which has got something written on the magnetic stripe at the back, which the card reader is reading. The card reader, once it realizes that is not a fake piece of card, then it asks you to put a pin in. So it is going through multiple steps. Then it checks the pin to see whether the pin is actually in file and is associated with your name. Right? So these multiple steps are going on for the authorization to happen. And then of course the money is finally collected. So there are various layers that one has to go through. We probably have only seen the branch banks. Branch banks report to a head office bank. And then it goes to interbank system. So let's say you're banking in Karnataka Bank, and your merchant is banking with State Bank of India, then there has to be a clearance process. There's a risk credit management process, there's securities financial, which is all interconnected from here. And then ultimately you have the central bank, in this case the RBI, in the case of India, RBI, which gets the ultimate settlement figures and keeps track of the transfers. Now, all this is in a banking scenario. What happens in a cash transaction? So you do have a buyer and a seller, but there's a whole lot of stuff going on. So Shalini gave me 2,000 rupees. Now it seems as though it's very straightforward, but there's a whole lot of stuff that is going on behind the scenes. So first, the central bank has to issue the fiduciary money. It has to have anti-forgery stuff. It has to have serial numbers. Serial numbers can never be duplicated. Maybe as you mentioned, that now they're holograms as well. So even the cost, there is a cost associated with the printing of the money. The coins that you use on a day-to-day basis are minted in Nasik. Does anyone know Nasik? Yeah, so it's minted in Nasik. I don't know where the notes are printed. Does anyone know? So in the US, it's well known that the cost of making a cent is substantially greater than the value, because there's a copper in the cent. I don't know if the Maya cent have copper in them or not. If I say, or not. No, I have said. 50 paise, 1 rupee. 1 rupee has a copper in it.
steel.
All steel. Oh, I see. So there's no copper. But some of 5 rupee or 10 rupee coins are from glass.
5 rupee. Looks like it's an alloy of copper bronze.
There is some alloy, right? So it's not just steel because I think it looks yellowish. So there are. Yeah, the 5 rupee, 10 rupee coins.
Previously,
okay. Maybe they're now phasing it out. The copper mines again, there's a problem because the resources are being eaten away. So there's a cost to the money. Central bank then has to sell the cash to the buyer's bank. The buyer's bank allows the buyer to draw cash. So which means there have to be banking, brick and mortar banks. There have to be ATMs, automated teller machines. Somebody has to go to the ATM on a daily basis and replace credit for money. The buyer physically gives cash to the seller. The seller then deposits the cash in the seller's bank account. And then seller's bank credits the seller's bank account. So even though it looks as though it's a very straightforward transaction, you take this bottle, for example, the merchant and you pay 10 rupees, there's a whole lot of stuff that is going on in the background. And in fact, I'm told that the cost of having an ATM is more than the value that it accrues to a bank. So if I'm not mistaken, there's the charge every time you go to an ATM, right?
Yeah, the first five transactions
free. After that, you start. So these are basically things that are taken care of by banks. You have the central banks that issue fiduciary money, both local and rotational. Then you have other non-central banks that issue scriptural money and non-fiduciary money. Then you have the non-central banks which accept deposits and so on. So remember that when you think of banks, what is the most important characteristic that comes to mind?
Safety and security.
Safety and security, which lead to trust, exactly. So trust is paramount in any banking situation. So anytime there is some hopla, you lose trust in the bank. Take out your money. Maybe deposit somewhere else. So that would have major repercussions for the bank. So the trust is extraordinarily important, and anything that the bank can do to increase trust, both from the point of view of security and safety, will and it's not just safety for the bank itself, because you have guards and you have barbed wire fences around the bank and so on. It's not just physical, but it's digital as well. We'll come back to that point later on, but I just wanted to bring that up for a moment. So we have bank accounts, which is essentially a rotational representation of a loan to the bank from a depositor. So I have $1,000, I deposit $200 in the bank, I basically have $800, I've given the bank a loan of $200. So my assets will be $800 in cash, $200 to the bank. The bank deposits are $200 in the central bank, which means that the bank now is at $200 of money and $200 of debt. So that debt will take care of at a certain point in time later on. But the bank now has the money with which it can essentially give out loans and get interest and so on and make money for you, and maybe as a depositor give you dividends and interest and so on. So that brings us to different types of settlement systems. You have gross settlement systems, you have net settlement systems. And again, depending upon the bank and the types of transactions, you would find these systems, every transaction is processed separately, sometimes immediately, sometimes instantaneously, and this is often used for interbank transfers, large volume transfers and so on. And then you have debt settlement systems where transactions are batched. So does it make sense to have, let's say, 100 rupee transactions being done instantaneously because of the cost associated with it? So that's done at the end of the day. Problem, of course, is time is the enemy of money. And this brings up the issue of flow. So when you deposit something in a bank, the money is not there in your account immediately, unless unless you have an account in the bank. So some other bank, the money will be, it has to clear and then go to, so it may take a week. How much is the flow? Do you know these days? If I give you a state bank and you don't have a state bank account, if you have a Karnataka bank account, how much time will it take you?
No, 2 days.
2 days, huh? Okay. So, so that's basically float. And float means that for 2 days you don't have that amount of money, it could potentially be utilized elsewhere. Which is an issue. So, what we see here is a picture of your clearing and settlement systems. And notice here, it's a real-time closed settlement system, which is called as RTGS, which is taking place on a real-time basis. And you're looking at the regional and local things. So large transactions that are going on is essentially the RTGS driving system. And just to give you a picture of the US check clearing, so there's a point of entry, which is a branch, an ATM, and a lockbox. So checks are basically picked up. 40 billion checks are being transferred on a day-to-day basis, and 2.1 billion checks are returned, which basically shows you the value of digital payments. So going beyond checks to digital payments, and you don't have to worry about all these things. Which actually also brings to mind, how many of you have seen Catch Me If You Can? Okay, so those of you who have not seen it, you must watch that movie. Best example of how to do fraud, how to do social engineering. So some of you may remember there was one scene where, so the hero in the movie is Leonardo DiCaprio. And there's one scene where it is changed. So all checks have a number at the bottom. This kind of a number. And so this is the bank number. So 0613, this is an example. This is the personal account number. So in the movie, Leonardo was changing 12 to 0. 16 to 06, something like that. 061. So 12 is New York branches and 02 is California branches. So he would hand in a fake check in a New York branch. You would get the money. But for the check to clear, he would have to go to California. And at that time, they would realize that it's a fake check. It's a very interesting movie. So if you haven't seen it, take a look at it. Anyway, the point is that you have this massive transportation going on of all kinds of checks, and then so many billions of dollars worth of checks are returned on a daily basis. So if you have okay, I lost my train of thought. Anyway, this is an example of a check from Carnegie Mellon University to Professor Michael Chamos for $100. And so look at what's going on in the check. there's so many different things that have to be taken care of. The pay name, the drawer name, the date, the amount, the currency type, the check number, the authorized signature of the baker's agent, the account number, the Royal Bank number. And the reason you need all this is that it's essentially what you're doing is when you're writing a check, it's an order to the bank to pay money to the in this particular case, it's like channels. So, if you look at the the clearing of the check, there's a whole bunch of things that are going on here. So, same you send the check to the human, the professor, Shamos. Pay Shamos 100. Then Shamos is a customer of Citibank, whereas CMU is a customer of Mellon Bank. And Citibank has to go through and make sure that Shamos is an authentic person. And then it credits Shamos. And then that's sent to the clearing house. Clearing house adds 100 to the city account, subtracts from Mellon. Then the clearing house adds Mellon debit info. Mellon deducts the 100 from the CMU account. And then the clearing house sends the check to Mellon and then back to it. So it's quite a complicated affair that is going on here. Now similarly, if you're looking at foreign exchange, you are not only looking at currency in a single nation, but you're looking at across nations. And so of course you're looking for, let's say you're doing a transaction in Japan and you want USD, so you want buy US dollar with Japanese yen, and so there is a barter transaction that is going on, and which is going on in real time. And this will give you an example of the foreign exchange barter that is actually going on. So you have a bank in the US, bank wants to buy 1 million GBP. What is GBP? Great Britain pound, right? So Great Britain pound, and so it goes to a bank in the UK that has a GBP account, which goes to the Bank of England, which is similar to RBI here, which is similar to the Federal Reserve. And then the account transfer is being done not between C and B, but some S, which is willing to send 1 million. And so C will connect with S, which will connect to a T, which then it becomes much more complicated. And this willingness has to be found for a foreign exchange transaction before. In addition, of course, having an account which can create liability. So that brings us to electronic money. We have various different types, and notice that we are talking about dematerialized monies because we are looking at information as the foundation for the monies. And your producing money can be stored in electronic form. You can have tokens, you can have QQ coins like on Facebook credits, and digital money like Digicash or Bitcoins, where essentially value is stored in the form of algorithms. So you could have electronic token holders like your telephone cards, which contain a certain amount of money. Once that money is over, then you have to replenish it. You can't do anything else with what you have on there. So this slide is a summary of the electronic purses. We have the
the different characteristics, electronic purse, electronic genome holder, which is open. So in this case it is unregulated, but here it is regulated by a bank. In this case it's legal tender, but here it's actually specific to transactions and depends on the consumption unit, and so that is being utilized. So the circuit of financial services in this case is open, and in this case is closed, basically meaning that this, what you see here, is not something that can be traded in the market. For example, you go to the metro, the metro token can be used for manually as a metro token. Right? So, you, the metro token can only be used in the Bangalore metro token, not used outside of it. It's basically closed system. Whereas these things you can use anywhere. And then, of course, you have the digital wallets, which is basically software that stores, access, and manages based on the information that it carries. Examples are Google Wallet, Apple Passport, and so on. So with so to summarize, what we have seen so far is the type of fiduciary or scriptural money. Fiduciary is concrete material, it is paper, piece of metal, stored in a safe, a wallet, or a purse. Bank notes, coins, and examples, face to face transactions. And the medium of those bank notes and coins. Then on the other hand, is the scriptural, which is dematerialized, which is basically account maintained by the credit. You have to be magnetic, optical, electronic, on your smartphone, could be in an electronic purse. It's basically some numerical value that is stored somewhere, which is being debit credited as and when the transfer happens. So, with all this, one has to be careful about security, because anybody, any crook, for example, would want to, so these days you have gentlemanly crooks, they don't want to beat you on the head or kill you. They would rather just get into your account and siphon off money digitally, right? So, so how do you resist that? In the olden days, you would hire bodyguards to make sure that you're not being clubbed. These days that doesn't work. So, the protocols must resist attacks from outside the system. And of course, inside the system too, we'll come to that later. So, must resist misappropriation by any one of the participants. So, so let's use the same names, Deepika and Ranveer. So, Deepika is sending money to Ranveer. And what's her name? Atish. So Deepika is sending, let's say, 1,000 rupees to Ranveer, and Atish is in the middle. Not this Atish, but some other Atish. And Atish changes the 3 zeros to 1 zero. I mean, deletes 1 zero. So what Ranveer gets is 100. And Atish siphons off the other 900, because Ranveer will never know. So that's a man in the middle attack. You're familiar with the man in the middle attack. So that's a man in the middle attack. And that basically is the third party, non-participant must not be able to intercept the message, to manipulate the content, modify orders, or resend valid but old messages. And must resist false charges, such as attributing the charge to a client other than the one identified, attributing an amount different from the requested one, repaying a previously authenticated charge, repudiating a previously correct executed charge. what does this mean? Repudiating a previously correctly executed charge. So, for example, Deepika says to Ranveer, I have sent 1,000 rupees, and then later on said, no, I never sent it. So, that is repudiation. So, how can you make sure that she actually did? Because it's quite possible that Atik is sitting there and he's sending the message. Right? So what is it that guarantees that it's actually Deepika who sent the message and not Atik? Anybody? So when Deepika is sending the message, what is it that must go along with the message to make sure that it's actually she who has sent it and not Atik? Identifier, what kind of identifier? Digital signature, right, exactly right. So, which is also very interesting because this concept of the digital signature came into being only when the concept of course existed, but digital signature as being legal came into being only when Bill Clinton was the president. Bill Clinton was the president.
94.
So, 92. So, not very long ago. I think in terms of look at the time the internet has been around, it is very recent that this signature became legal entity. So, and of course, must be robust to return to the previous state if there is an error. So, if there's a mistake, it has to be able to fallback, what is the fallback? The fallback, can it fall back to the original state before the transaction happened? So these are security requirements. And in addition, of course, you have payment gateways in electronic commerce. Payment gateway is your e-commerce application service provider who is essentially authorizing the credit card or payment processing that is going on. And that is a facilitator, so it's separate from a brick and mortar or separate from an online retailer. That is essentially where the transfer of information is going on between a payment portal and merchant and the issuer bank and so on. And require bank. So that is a new entity that is coming with the advent of electronic commerce. And then you also have payment intermediaries who facilitate the transactions between third parties. These intermediaries are not actually taking title to those being sold. So, for example, PayPal is an intermediary and an entity that keeps track of transactions would be an intermediary because the merchant and the payer are not adequately worried about those things. So, if you look at the history of digital payments, the digital payments, online payments actually began in the 1990s. As I mentioned to you, digital signatures, Clinton actually signed the legislation to make digital signatures legitimate and legal. So look at, so 1940 you had credit cards, 1960 you had ATMs. 1970 you had debit cards, you had branchless banks, online banking which had an ATM. PayPal, which later on was essentially bought by eBay, was not at this time. And that was a natural acquisition for eBay, because eBay was involved with P2P transactions, where it was necessary for some kind of escrow. You needed to have that middle person for a trusted transaction to take place. So PayPal was natural for eBay. And you have coin cards here, that's where the Bitcoin came into being. And then of course you have mobile wallets. So most of the major innovations have happened in the last 15 years. Bitcoin was 2009. Later on you have Apple Pay and so on and so on. So PayPal was established in 1998, was sold to eBay in 2002. And I bring that in here because it was the first company that allowed peer-to-peer money transfer without having to go through the central banks. So as we shall see later, the central banks do come into the picture because there's money being transacted. So PayPal at that time did provide limited fraud protection. But it was able to connect payment gateways and facilitate the eBay transactions that how many have you heard of M-Pesa? What one is? Huh? Right. So M-Pesa is it's a Kenyan scheme. Money transfer system, which originally started as microfinance. And does anybody know what PISA stands for? What does it mean? So PISA in Swahili is money. So M-PISA means mobile money. So the reason why we bring it up is that this was probably the single most utilized mobile money transfer system in the world, which essentially brought Kenya to the top of the world in terms of mobile money transfer. There's a lot of history that goes on, which we may not talk about, but. If anyone is talking about mobile money, M-Pesa is always one of the actors in the mobile money. And cryptocurrency, many of you are familiar with Bitcoin and blockchain and all that. So you can buy it through different wallets. The reason why it's become so much of a major player today is because of what? Why has it become such a major player in the monetary transfer mechanisms? Yes, it's outside the regulatory framework. And because you can basically do these transactions anonymously while being sure that you are not going to be defrauded. So of course that is a but if I'm not mistaken, it's legal in India. It's legal in
India.
It's not legal. You have to declare it as an asset. Okay. And if you do not declare it as an asset, then?
It's also illegal money.
So this is probably going to be the future of money. So to summarize what we have done so far, we have looked at debit card, credit cards, mobile in-store payments, apps, digital currency, which is not regulated by the government, like Bitcoin, Ethereum, so on. Like e-wallets, ability to purchase, Venmo, PayPal, Cash App, and so on. And then, of course, social media payment, like Snapchat, without having to transfer the bank. So the challenges that we see, how many of you are familiar with PCI DSS? So, I'll come to that in a couple of minutes, but basically it is a form of certification that is required for every merchant that is dealing with credit and debit card payments. So next time you go to a merchant who is willing to accept your credit card or debit card, ask that merchant, are you PCI DSS certified? Go to Big Bazaar tomorrow and ask them, are you PCI DSS certified? And if they say no, then you can raise another. So we'll come to this in the next couple of slides, but this certification is important. So the issue of fraudulent charges, online transactions are card not present transactions that can result in fraud and data theft. What that means is, when I go online and type in my number, that is different from card present, which is I present my card to the retailer and there is a point of sale, I swipe the card, right? So my card is present at the time that the transaction is going on. So the difference between card not present transactions and card present transactions, which I'll talk about in a minute. And then, of course, these processors may be expensive or difficult to connect to other processing systems. So, fear of mobile security, there is different types. You have theft from linked accounts, you have unauthorized charges, stolen passwords. So where do we find the different vulnerabilities? Digital payments are not a single action. There are key players involved in a digital payment, ranging from the device itself, the merchant, the point of sale system, the financial institution, the card distribution organization. And you could have problems or vulnerabilities if any of the key players fail in their security measures. And as you know, you have to look out for the weakest link in the chain. So even if all these are very strong and this one is weak, that means you have essentially a major vulnerability. So what are the different types of attacks and vulnerabilities? You have HTTPS attacks, you have phishing attacks, ransomware, cyber espionage, SQL injection. All of you have probably studied these things, right? Yeah. Okay. And if you look at the number of cyber attacks, you notice that phishing, distributed denial of service, spam, these are at the top. In malware, cyber espionage, identity theft, and supply chain. So, the human related exploits are often more or equal to the non human related exploits, like virus. So, coming back to PCI DSS. So, CIS payment card industry, PSS and data security. And a study that was done recently found that places that had multiple compromises essentially did not follow the PCI system. So every merchant is supposed to be PCI DSS certified. Every merchant who uses a credit card or debit card is supposed to be PCI DSS. And this is the basic requirement and we're basically looking at compliance, non-compliance, or not applicability. And so notice that you have several things, and I've just given you a few of them, depending upon the amount of transactions that are going on. It may range from as few as 30 requirements to 245 requirements. And so the larger the merchant, the larger meaning the larger number of transactions that the merchant accepts, the more requirements would be required. It would have to be compliant. For example, you have a restrict access to cardholder, data by businesses that need to know. So there's a need to know issue here, and then track and monitor all access to network resources. Regularly test security systems and processes. Maintain a policy. Does a policy exist in the organization about security? So this is, in a nutshell, what PCIDSS is about. Which brings us to digital payments in India. And I think this is one of the mantras that you see today: faceless, paperless, cashless. So this is the digital payments ecosystem in India, which ranges from banking cards, USSD, prepaid cards, point of sale, and so on. So every one of you probably has used all these things. So you have banking cards, of course. Then you have unstructured supplementary service data, which is essentially allows mobile transactions. You have Aadhaar-enabled payment system, APS. UPI, Unified Payments Interface, which allows peer-to-peer collections. And then, of course, you have all these different players in the ecosystem. So we see that there are a number of challenges in making India a cashless economy. The reason, of course, is that we need to have financial inclusion. So there is the problem of availability of internet connection and financial literacy. This scheme called Jan Dhan Yojana. All of you familiar with that? So apparently, a lot of accounts were opened under that scheme, but they are unopened, unoperative. There's vested interest in not moving towards cashless economy. And why is that? Black money. Yeah. And India is dominated by small retailers. They often don't have enough resources to invest in electronic payment. So what we see here is it's making progress, it is making progress. And what we see is that there is a spike in digital payments. There is a spike in electronic funds transfer, retail payments, and so on. We see here. Interestingly, there is a drop here. And why is that? So all retail electronic payments dropped suddenly the last quarter in the
demonetization
was somewhere here, right? 2016.
Yes.
Yeah, but retail payments have decreased, right?
Retail payments, KYC. Retail electronic payments has increased, KYC.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not sure why. You mentioned GST, that may be one of the reasons why. What are the recommendations for promotion of digital payments? Obviously, open bank accounts, ensure they're operational. abolish fees on credit card transactions, increase taxes on ATM withdrawals, the tax rebates for customers and merchants who adopt electronic payments. And this is critical, make electronic payment infrastructure safe and secure. And so that cyber crimes are minimized. And then of course, the point of view of RBI, what digital payments across border means for its control. Any questions before we take the tea break? Yeah. Yeah, so that's a good point. The question is, who can be that entity that vertically integrates everything? So if you say it should be RBI will say that RBI is in the business of money at the central level. It does not want to be involved with point of sale systems at the lower level. So each organization has a limit to where it can expand. Others have to basically take it up in the ecosystem. So the advantage of having these various, each individual entity in that case can specialize on its own. And of course you need careful overlook at the boundaries, but within the system, each entity will be doing its own. And the analogy I can give you is the motor car industry. There was a time when it started becoming vertically integrated, but now it is again. Because there are economies of scale which you cannot handle, for example. So there are, if you take Ford, for example, or General Motors, vertical integration would mean going right to the iron ore mine and mining for iron and then converting into steel and so on. But Ford by itself cannot handle all this. So I started moving on. Any other questions? Okay.
Is it a good thing to have? I mean, hypothetically imagine that there is one entity which is prepared to do all of us. If so, is it a good thing to have one of the NASA?
So that's where the monopolism, restrictive trade practices, all those things come into the picture, because then they can set their prices and the customer is at a loss. So that's exactly what's happening. When companies are trying to vertically integrate, the government is coming in and saying, okay, some companies can do that, but others cannot. And the rationale is, how much more monopoly is it going to?
I know probability where there is cases, those two, three in the chain can integrate rather than the whole chain. At least those where the probability of vulnerability is high, that can be a single.
That's a good point. The question then is, where exactly is the highest probability of all? It's not an easy question to answer. Because vulnerabilities keep opening up with time. What may be a vulnerability today may not be a vulnerability tomorrow. what may be completely solid defense today may not be solid defense tomorrow. So it's very highly dynamic in nature. So practically, I'm not sure that it would work. Okay, thank you. Take a tea break and go back.
Thank you, sir. We will now take a short break for 15 minutes and gather again for the session 2 of Masterclass after the
break. It's interesting card move. We accept PayPal, we accept any method that pays, which is what ultimately digital payments is about. So, we saw in the previous lecture that we had different types of digital money, physical cash. As far as India was concerned, mobile banking was introduced in 2000. But India as a nation is still heavily dependent on cash. And government of India initiated demonetization on November 16th. 2016. 86% of banknotes in circulation had to be exchanged. With the shortage of new banknotes, people started using digital payments, including mobile payments, because they were forced to. But now cash is back in circulation. And the question is, will people continue or abandon mobile payments? So to review what we did earlier, we had various forms of payment. This cartoon actually exemplifies this quite well. The beggar who takes credit cards and has a device for taking the credit cards. So we're looking at digital payments which are made through digital modes without transfer of anything that we can see or feel, like banknotes, coins, checks, and so on. And both payer and payee use digital modes to send and receive money. So we have seen this all over the world. We see digital payments have been increasing in the both in terms of digital wallets as well as credit and so on. So payments around the world which have increased. And the categories of digital payments for financial inclusion are critical for financial inclusion, because the ultimate goal is that the poor should also be able to access financial services. So if I can go back 40 years, I had a friend who was a money lender, and he would lend. Actually, he was the son of a money lender, and his father would lend money at the rate of 10% per month. Is that a big number or not? It's great. And obviously people would not be able to pay that much. And so he had this bunch of mungas whom he had hired. So I didn't know too much about the parents for quite a while. Until I got, someone told me the story that this guy had beaten up some people. So after that I decided I would not be as stingy with him as I used to. But the reason I bring this is that because the poor don't have access to banks, and if they go to banks, banks will think of them as a risky loan. So they don't give them loans. ultimately they, the only place they can go to are these money lenders. But with digital inclusion coming in, the role of the money lender obviously, as probably started to increase. And so it's a global priority for to have financial inclusion, not just a national priority. And best example is again back to M-Pesa in India. So the ultimate goal is to go to a non-cash society is probably possible. So in a sense, what they're looking for is a cash-light society. You have cash at times when it's absolutely necessary, but most of the times you go for a digital-based society. Ultimately, which would result in reduction of poverty and reduction of income to the So we're looking at a situation where both the payer and the payee are using electronic media, in contrast to ATMs where the payer is digital but the payee is cash. We are looking for both digital mechanisms under the mobile media. So we have seen so many different categories of mobile payments. How many of you use Paytm? How many use MobiQuick?
One.
How many recharge?
Only one.
So, do you use recharge in addition to Paytm or?
Sometimes I will have unique offers. So now we work on the checking mobile, unique offer.
That incentive is important. And apps, you have Beam, 4K, Days. How many use Beam?
Very large number.
4K, Days. Okay, so I notice here almost everybody is using Days. Any particular reason?
Scratch card.
So again, it's basically an incentive scheme, right? Yes. The others are not. So this how much does it come back to your account? Is it for every purchase or?
It's like initially it's
targeted
that if you refer your friend to download the app, both of you get 50 rupees. After that, it's just based on your luck. You might get 10 rupees, 12 rupees or nothing. Some people have gone up to 1,000.
By getting everybody to join? Then you said there's a cash back scheme also. How much is that?
Not cash back, but scratch cards.
Oh, scratch cards.
So it's based on money.
It's based on money. Okay, that's a good incentive. Okay. And of course, banks, everybody is, has their own bank using mobile banking. Then the USSD, which is using quick codes, which basically is star 99 plus. How many of you use this? So, when we look at the history of payments in India, of course, primarily it was cash, and then 2000 mobile banking was introduced. A study in 2014 found that despite the advantages, there's reluctance among customers to adopt services. And for years, if you compare it to other emerging economies, India and Philippines were way ahead. So then, 2016 November, when the demonetization, and 86% cash invalid, so that essentially changed everything. So if you look at this slide, so we start from the 1990s, go to the 2010s here. So notice that with each event that is happening, the ecosystem is getting stronger and stronger. So 1990s, the economy was liberalized. That was a key factor actually, which is leading now to the digital payment. So, Visa, MasterCard, they came to play. Then you had the national financial switch, which is a shared ATM switch. The real-time draw settlement system, which I talked about in the earlier payment tweet. And NEFT, which is a national electronic funds transfer for interbank transfer. And this was 30-minute settlement. So remember, I said time is a problem. So this is essentially by cutting down on the settlement time, you are allowing minimization of flow, and obviously people are much more inclined to manage transactions. So Aadhaar came in 2000s. Everybody has an Aadhaar card. And then the National Electronic Clearing System, which was second generation electronic clearing system, late 2000. Then IMPS, which is immediate payment service using existing NFS networks, improving NEFT, RTGS. And then RuPay. All of you have used RuPay?
Yes.
So it's a domestic debit card network, with a launch as an alternative to Visa and Mastercard. So I guess the idea is that Visa, MasterCard are foreign, we need a domestic network. And then we are getting into mid-2010s, National Unified USSD platform, mobile text banking services. So this is critical because this is, you don't need to have smartphones for mobile banking. And the National Automated Clearing House, the NACH, web-based payment system for interbank transfers. The Bharat Bill Pay system, integrated payments for multiple types of bills. So, what set everything off was the economic liberalization of the 1990s. It was under which government? Was the key architect for this. I think Manmohan Singh was not the Prime Minister at that time, he was the Finance Minister. So then we, so that was a key event, and then of course Aadhaar was another key event, which basically is the proliferation of India's digital IT platform. So these two are basically what led to the digital payment as well. Then when we go on, 2016-2017, so some more key things come into the picture. There is APPS, Aadhaar Payments Bridge System, which uses Aadhaar as a primary factor of authentication for transfer of government benefits and subsidies. So your ration card is using Aadhaar, right? Which one?
It links to Aadhaar.
Links to Aadhaar, right? And gas also. AEPS, Aadhaar Enabled Payment System. that allows delivery of basic financial services, and then UPI, which is the unified payment interface, which essentially allows the authentication. And so all these fit under UPI. So you have sender authentication. Traditionally you had PIN and password, now you have digital identity. Your biometrics comes in. Receiver identification, account number, card, point of sale, mobile wallet, so it's authentication and virtual debit access. Bank authorizes transaction once first steps are complete. Now you can enable push and pull based on, of course, two-factor authentication. And then information in the transaction process, money transfer across rails using RTGS, etc. Here you standardize the first steps to process the transaction. So the combination of all these has essentially caused the creation of a world-class payment system. And making use of these, you have your companies like Paytm, Airtel, and so on. And then there's one other example I wanted to bring out, the Bharat QR. Basically, you use the QR codes for payment transfers. Anybody use the QR codes? I think even the Chaiwala these days will accept the QR codes. And the good thing about that is you do not really need the internet. It's outside. The communication linkages happen outside of the internet. And it is instantaneous, so that transaction can settle immediately. So what are the benefits? Clearly there are a lot of benefits of the cashless economy, but specifically for the poor, and I refer to Chakravarti in the Harvard Business Review. He's written an article called The Hidden Cost of Cash. So he talks about fees. So for example, if you have a construction worker who wants to get some money, then she has to go to an ATM, which means that there will be ATM fees, or has to go to a banking correspondent, which is actually one of the things that M-Pesa had when it first started its network in Kenya. The banking correspondents charge their commission. Then you, of course, you have queuing time. So you have to stand in long queues. Whether it's at the ATM or whether it's at the payment collector. Cash has higher risk of theft. So if there's an accidental loss or theft, then it's impossible to recover cash. And then if it is held in home under the mattress, then obviously it cannot be reinvested and you cannot gain any interest. And inflation will erode the value. So fundamentally, cash is not king. Keep saying cash is king, but cash is definitely not king. So when we get to a cash light, as I mentioned, we cannot really have a cash less economy, but it's cash light. So from the point of view of the government, more financial inclusion of the citizens, eradication of black money. So GOI introduced various measures like having microfinance institutions, basically concept of a group of villagers who would access an account. So maybe 30 or 40 villagers would be accessing one account through the accountant. And 268,000 banking outlets have been set up in villages. 490 million transactions were carried out in each country accounts. So demonetization was of course a big step which caused a rise in population. From the point of view of the government, the other advantage of going cash light is that there are a lot of people who try to avoid taxes. And if you close that gap, it would not be necessary for government to increase taxes for people. More people fall under the network of tax-paying people, then there will be no need for the government to increase taxes. So, all in all, it has a major impact on financial improvement. So, post 2016, mobile wallet transactions increased by 167%. Mobile banking, of course, grew by 236%. Reliance Jio was a critical partner. Of course, we don't know about their profitability, but the fact that they did create value, that is uncontrolled. We cannot dispute that. And of course, ATM was one of the first in the field. ATM, if I'm not mistaken, is also funded by Alibaba. Right? Yeah, okay. So, say over 300 million unique customers, and this is a this tweet is dated 8th November 2016, so when the demonetization happened, this was the tweet that Paytm sent out. We have two words for you, Paytm. So, pretty neat ad, right? So, the response to demonetization and helping the digitization process. So Paytm of course has gone on to do great things. So you have the Paytm wallet, you have the Paytm payments bank, you have everything of course is built on the infrastructure, you have Paytm mall, Paytm marketplace, Paytm financial services. So there are offerings upon offerings that are being as you mentioned the concept of verticals, so they are also looking for at verticals where they can make value, where they can co-create value. So payments were of course the first hook, but beyond that there are various other things that are going on in the process. So the question of financial inclusion how do mobile payments aid in greater financial inclusion, particularly in the context of the rural citizens having non-bank accounts? So this has helped in the value creation. So the banking outlet, the small business owner, the consumer who was previously unbanked, the government of course, most of there's value being created in all these different areas, and this is proof that companies like ATM are doing well outside of the governmental situation. So what we see is various contextual events that have helped in the mobile payment adoption. We had a major drop in Reliance Jio, Jio's another program, cash shortage of course, recharge, discount offering from the wallets, high perceived risk for alternative digital payments. 74,000 was lost by a default with registered credit card fraud. And Earning from Jharkhand credit for debit card scam. Anybody from Jharkhand? So it's 2 years post demonetization and cash is back in circulation. And the question is Are the users going to continue using mobile payments? Or are they going to discontinue? And so to answer the question, we get into the theory of affordances, which would help us to understand certain contextual factors. And of course, also understand the usage and how the usage is being influenced by mobile payment companies. So we go through three research questions. Do users who adopted mobile payment services after demonetization plan to continue using the technology instead of reverting to cash? What are the affordances, which is basically features that support the usage, and constraints, which are barriers influencing the continued use of mobile payment technology? And how do mobile payment companies influence the continued use of mobile payment technology? So, the literature before we get to the literature, the research motivation is to understand what can promote financial inclusion and why users choose to continue or discontinue mobile payments. So, the literature in this area has typically focused on adoption. There is an abundance of adoption models, and the primary adoption model that is often used is by Rogers, who wrote a paper on the diffusion of innovation theory, and he came up with certain characteristics for adoption of innovation. But in our case, we are not looking at adoption anymore, because people have adopted. Now we are looking at whether people are interested in continuing or dropping out. So the demonetization which happened in 2016 was the crux for people to adopt. So we are no longer worried about the adoption. Now are they going to drop it or continue with it? And that's the principle. So from the point of view of the government, it is an important question, and in fact, RBI is making. In fact, Shalini sent me a newspaper story about another delegate being last week. Yeah, so it's actually cutting edge. RBI is another delegate is basically going to head the committee. RBI's committee for financial inclusion, and this is last week, so hot off the press. So what is affordance theory about? What affordance theory says is that we have an artifact, and this slide is basically an example of. So, affordance will come out as an interplay between actors, the environment, and the artifact itself. So, when the three of them have an interplay, then the affordance will play out differently. So, if you look at this one, we are looking at a white sheet of paper. Ability to write on it, that's the activity, the student, the environment, the classroom. But when a child is playing with that same sheet of paper, and making a boat, and they're playing in a tub or in a river, and when someone's giving a gift, the same sheet of paper becomes a wrapping mechanism for some festival. So the artifact is the same in each case. It's a white sheet of paper, but it is what happens in the interplay of the actors, the environment, and the artifact that essentially shows the usage. And that is what essentially we are looking at. So for this we go to a paper by Marshak and Marcus, where they talk about goal-oriented use of the objects environment afford a meaning? And then are there constraints that limit an individual from realizing the desired goal? So, go back here, what are the constraints? So, let's say there is no stream or river or water, then it doesn't make any sense to make a boat. Maybe you can make an airplane, but it doesn't make any sense to make a boat if there is a constraint. Similarly, if there is no festival, then what is the value of wrapping something? So there are constraints in every situation which act as barriers to the use of a particular artifact. So we use technology affordances, and we also draw on assistive technology, which is basically the technology for that is used for people with disabilities. So assistive technology has concepts of adoption and usage that are similar to what we are looking at. So what are the different affordances that positively influence usage? We have accessibility, offers access to vast amounts of information, how we use, what is usability, what is usability. Network externalities is, I use because others, all my friends are using. And the best example of this is the fax. So if you have one fax machine, nobody's going to use it. If you have thousands of fax machines, then people are going to use it. The ability to respond to changing needs, that comes from assistive technology, where you use a, let's say, cane, a blind person uses a cane to walk. The cane needs to be utilized in multiple places. You can't say, okay, I can use it only in the classroom. I can use it only in the street. You have to be able to use it elsewhere. So, depending on where you are, the needs will change. And the ability to respond in those changing environments. Then, of course, we look at pricing discounts and the concept of reflection, which basically is where how past transaction details can be captured. So, cash is one thing where you cannot capture any past transaction details. On the other hand, blockchain is where you can capture all transaction details from day one. So, those are the various affordances, and you just mentioned phase giving pricing discounts or other types of incentives. That's apparently a big thing in this context. With regard to constraints which negatively influence usage, you have unavailability of facilitating conditions, risk, and then surveillance. People think that going digital means that the government is going to survey what you are doing. Make sure they are going to track all your movements, all your financial transactions are going to be tracked. So then, of course, you have design constraints which have to do with the technologies. And then we have the moderators. Moderators being the merchants. ATM, as you know, is very highly popular. Amazon, though it does allow, it does not have link to any popular wallets. And some retail stores provide QR code. So, the way the merchant will have a relationship with the consumer will make an impact on the usage. So again, going back to today's example, they're giving it this incentive. That will help the consumer to buy it into the system, into the days. Okay. You also have the payment app providers. You have Paytm, you have PhonePay, you have Google Pay, you have Bill. And then of course, Paytm also has several bundled services. Which make it a basket of services that are very required. So all of these lead us to this model, the affordances and the constraints leading to continuing usage of mobile gaming technology. And we have these as moderators, the merchant influence and the volunteer. So, so as far as the dependent variable, we are looking at two types of dependent variables. One is, of course, the intention to continue. So, meaning we ask people, will you be continuing with the digital payment or will you be reverting to cash? So, that's an intention. In contrast, you have actual continuous behavior. Have you actually continued over since the cash trust no longer exists? So this, of course, includes complete continuous to complete continuous. And there are several studies that have captured potential to continue. We are looking at both potential to continue and actual behavior as well. So in terms of the actual usage, the source of this is digital payments because of Ph.D, which is a Google report. Unorganized retail is at the top. Then you have bill and utility payments, trade, rent, professional services, restaurants, e-commerce, complex, and so it includes all these things, ride sharing, paying local vendors, transactions, online retail stores, online order food, prepaid mobile bill payments, ticket booking, movies, and so on. And if you look at the different segments of where they're actually being used, so consider ride share, taxis, Uber, Lyft, and Ola, and so on. So cash is still much higher. This is two is Uber, and red is Ola. So you have 65% is still cash, whereas the wallet is 30%. And for Ola, it is higher for wallet, whereas cash is 37%. So how come Ola is so much more than Uber as far as the wallet is concerned? All of you use Ola? All of you use Uber? We have a sense of why this difference. Anyway, something to think about. If you think about transit connecting or anything, I don't know.
Also, Ola Auto, three wheeler. There's Ola three wheeler.
Ola three wheeler. Oh. But I guess this is for all of Ola.
Many more Ola customers
be using the wallet.
Petrol.
That is, if you buy something on the platform, you get Ola call in cash, but you won't get Uber cash or something like that. Two other platforms.
Oh, I see.
So there is money added to your wallet in Ola which you can convert later. For example, on Paytm, if you do some transactions, it will give you things where you can add cash to your Ola account. But there is no related third party services that Uber collaborating with other Indian servers.
Okay. So clearly that is a Uber has not been proactive in getting. Then of course we have movie tickets, which is movie tickets are pretty high for mobile movement, which I assume is everybody is using mobile movement for movie tickets. So the usage would of course be dependent upon which sector you are looking at, whether it's the taxi or the retail or the movie or the local shop. And if you look at the local shops, still cash is here. Mobile wallet is here, debit and credit. Here, mobile wallet is definitely better, even as compared to cash. So we did a survey, did a round of pre-test, and then did a pilot. We did a pre-test with 480 respondents. We got valid responses from 334 from various backgrounds and groups. However, I have to confess that the respondents were all friends of students at IIM Bangalore, and so what you see here is going to be quite biased. It's not a random sample. So we had only 30% female. Constraints, surveillance seems to be a fairly important factor. People are worried about the government tracking them. Risk is a little less, and then design constraints, people are not really worried about. Unavailability of facilitating conditions is not that big a deal. And more specifically, if you're looking at the different, so these are the different survey questions for accessibility, visibility, ability to respond, network externalities, price discounts, reflection. And then for constraints, surveillance versus risk. And, unavailability of facilitating conditions design seems to be least important of all the things. So so with regard to usage intentions,
majority of people say that they would intend to continue using mobile phones rather than discontinue. So that is actually good news from this sample. And then going beyond, we're looking at the app providers. So see, Google Pay, Taze is here, and Amazon Pay is here, and then Paytm. So that's good. So this gives you a picture of sort of reflects what the class is also saying about Paytm and Google Pay. So, and from that sample, we see the ad, of course, is also still up there. We see movie tickets, mobile recharge, bill payments, much higher than the others. And then these are still so the new markets opening up, like Zomato and Swiggy. How many have used this? So this is the model that we have based on our analysis so far. It seems as though the constraints do not have too much of a significance except for surveillance. The other constraints are not that, so this is not significant, this is marginally significant, this is quite significant, it's not significant at all. And in part, from the point of view of the affordances, these three are critical. Network external, price discounts, inspection, they are not that important anymore. But these three are critical. Accessibility, usability, and mobility. So I guess why price discounts, which you brought up, is no longer that critical. It might be that everyone is giving price discounts. Correct? So, as far as research is concerned, we have used a new theory to analyze the concept of continuance, and as far as practice is concerned, we hope that this will ultimately help government in India to figure out what can actually. So from the point of view of the model that we saw that surveillance is the major constraint. And perhaps government can do something in regard to that as well as well. And then designers of mobile payment apps can benefit from knowing what type of affordances have a greater impact on continuance. In conclusion, we used affordances literature as a theoretical lens. We feel that post-demonetization provides a perfect field study environment, and we capture actual continuance in addition to intentions. And of course, we are too late to understand the shock effect, but still, it has some value. So, that's it for today. Any questions? Sorry?
The sample, your sample
is a major problem. Because you started with poor inclusion, etc. So, your sample of, you know, IIM students, they have the pain of system.
Yeah, so the sample, just to clarify, is not just IIM students, it's IIM students' friends.
Yeah,
who are not necessarily
IIM students. No, still the same.
Yeah, yeah.
If you are looking at, see, for example, demo affect, supposed to have affected, informal sector, right? So we have to look at the informal sector in order to see the whether the long-term benefits are used, intend to use, etc., rather than people like us.
Yes, that is absolutely correct. So this is a, I would say, not a good sample. You are absolutely right.
Including, for example, I don't know, surveillance, whether it matters to the poor or not, it matters to the rich or the educated. Right? So we just don't want somebody to, or the government to have an eye on what I'm doing. Not because I have something to hide, but I just don't want anybody to know. But does it matter to the poor? I'm not too sure.
True. So there are 2 points here. It may not matter to the poor, or it might. We don't know yet. So that is actually something that we will be doing in the future, expanding the sample to a more representative population, which has both rural and urban populations. That's what we intend to do.
We procure sometimes goods, sometimes capital machinery from foreign sources. So the payment what we have is like letter of credit and TT transfer. So is it also coming under any kind of like digital payments, or can you tell more about that?
Yeah, so list in my earlier lecture before 3:30. Look, there are various like starting with debit cards and credit cards and all that, and so there's a whole list of things which fall under the digital payment. Mobile is an aspect of digital payment.
Yeah, so you have certain payments where one part is electronic, the other part is not. So for example, the ATM, you have cash coming in, right? Whereas the information that is going is digital. So today, every payment mechanism, there is some digital aspect. And depending on the payment mechanism, the entire thing could be digital, some part could be not digital. So what you are saying would fall under the broader umbrella of digital payments, but not specifically with regard to mobile.
One question, sir. I want to know, what is the risk as a buyer when we are executing either of the payment? What is the risk as a purchaser, buyer?
Okay. So again, I have to go back to the previous lecture, it was not here. So from the point of view of the buyer, so that was in the previous lecture. So from the point of view of the buyer, there could be risks like fraud. You make a purchase and the seller sends you something of bad quality. So you have to pay on receipt, but you don't see the quality of the good till later on. If you are focusing on the digital payment system itself, then you have all this whole list of possibilities, right? Man-in-the-middle attacks, ransomware. The fraud that I showed earlier, the 75,000 rupees in cash was stolen from the credit card account. So all these are buyer related issues. The simplest is, you know, people hacking into your account, and the simplest way of explaining the risk is people hacking into your account and you're using a password that is very simple. So yesterday's news, there is now a website where you can go and put in your name, I mean your email address, and it will tell you whether your credentials have been compromised at any point in time. Possibly I forget the name of the, but it was yesterday's news. So you can put in your password and it will tell you has that password been compromised. Or not that, let me repeat this. Has that password been in the list of databases that have been compromised? So every day you see a lot of databases that have been compromised, right? Yahoo, how many of you have Yahoo accounts? Nobody? You have. So, I think it was last year that several hundred million people were, their data was compromised. Were you part of that? No. You're lucky. I'll send Shalini the website. Maybe you can circulate it, and so if you go to the website, it will tell you whether that a password that you have used has it been in a list of the databases that have been compromised. So it's not necessarily that you have been compromised, but that password exists in a database that has been compromised. So it's a good exercise. So I found that. When she introduced me, she told you that I was from originally at Buffalo and then moved there. So my buffalo.edu account has been compromised 8 times. But my current one, University of Texas, has been compromised 0 times. So either I have grown wiser or the systems are better here. Yeah.
Yeah.
So the one other factor that I thought was trust, and the linking thing to that is the scarcity value. During the demonetization, why people used? Because the currency availability was scarce, so they thought this was easy. Movie tickets, because there are limited number of seats, so you can't go stand in the queue, so you book. But when it comes to payments, there is nothing scarce about it, you know. That is, then it becomes a matter of preference. So to create that scarcity value, in a way, they're creating all these coupons and discounts and all that. So there are limited number of offers, so you do that, you will get that. So somehow it is all through that scarcity value, but still trust is not there, is what I feel. Physical cash itself is a fiat money. In that, the online is the next form of it. So trust in a fiat through another fiat. So that's how it is, and people don't trust it, is what I feel, more than all the other factors. Be it educated people or the people from the informal sectors. Payment in online, people might not trust. You have to ask 100 times whether you received the payment I made, or whether it was credited, it was debited in your account, or so many such things. You give cash, it's done. So I think demonetization going to digital was because of the scarcity value. Now that it's not scarce again, people will still prefer cash.
It's a good point. So when we do the next sample, I think it will be corporate trust. Thanks for the good suggestion. Yeah. Any other questions?
Yeah. We have started a new thing actually. It's basically a crowdfunding platform. Okay. We have started a crowdfunding platform to help farmers, okay? So the initial, it's a digital payment. We'll get the payments from any payment gateways. So they'll be charging us 2% on every transaction. So that's fine. We get the payments, and when we have to return back to the investors, what medium should we choose? Like, is it RTGS or again with the payment gateways, we have to settle them back.
So your question is, you want to pay back to the crowdfunders?
Yes.
And you want to know which payment mechanism to choose?
Choose, yes. Because initially, they'll be charging us 2% to pay the payment request, which is high, considering the huge amount which is coming inside. So when it's going outside, also, if you pay 2%, the 4% cash is gone, just in the commission thing. So, and even the payment gateway take days to settle to the customers. So, what would be the best choice?
So, I don't have the answer to that question. That's probably a contextual, in the Indian context. Does anybody have the answer? Question.
Yeah,
because I didn't understand clearly, why should you pay back to the people who have given it to you?
Okay, see, what our platform is, basically farmers take loans, right, it's like a capital for them to buy seeds and fertilizers. So what we are trying to do is, we'll take the cash from the investors, like you people, it's just like 200, 300 bucks, we'll take it and we'll put it into an account. Then we'll buy seeds and fertilizers and train the farmers to grow the crop. Then we'll only sell the crops to the all the types. We have types with other companies. We'll sell it back and we'll get a margin, profit margin. So some profit margin we'll add it to the investors' money and return it to them. Okay. So while returning to them, it's a batch process. It's totally after 3 months after the crop is grown. So what we are thinking is, we don't have any payment method to totally give them back, and even the commission is like, it's 2% normally for every transaction. So that's the problem we are facing.
I think it boils down to the transaction cost, and it is price. What he is telling me is, while you're getting also, you're paying 2%, and while you're returning also, you're paying 2%, which is very high. I mean, even
even today, aren't there some, I don't use any of these things at all, so I'm not too sure. But I know when you use a credit card or something, there are, even big shops who are reluctant to do it. They say, they prefer cash. I don't know what is the reason. And they give that, the thing that it is the transaction cost. They say that they have to pay the transaction cost. And in some places they say, if you pay cash, we will give you a discount. But if you pay by this, I think it is also related to transaction cost, which is documented. I don't understand.
So, even on online payments, like Instamojo, that it's 1.9% is the commission that they charge. And that is the cost of you doing your business, because you are leveraging the platform to get money from someone and give it to somebody else, and that is, you earn a profit on that. And the cost of doing that business is this. Otherwise, if you have to go collect the money and come and give, and then come collect the money back and give it to, you have various transportation costs and all that. If you do NEFT also, there are a lot of additional costs that you incur. You are leveraging a platform where there is abstraction of anyone can come and easily pay to you. So you are choosing an easy way to get money to your organization, but finding it difficult to give back. Right? So it's the cost of doing business. You can tell all your investors to pay through NEFT to you. You can also do NEFT. Or you can tell all your customers to give a DD. You can also give a DD for that. But you're choosing a convenient way to get the things done. So when you're choosing convenience, the percentage they charge is the price that you pay.
Yeah.
So there's always a trade-off, right?
Yeah, the trade-off, I get it. Like, while the money is coming from the investors, the 2% is fair amount, because we are getting it into the system. And while giving it back, it's like a batch process. It's not like I have to send only you, money to you. It's like I have to send it to everyone.
Yeah.
So is there any method? Like, it's a batch process, right? So the percentage can be very low. Like 2%, it was like peer to peer, so that was fine. So while giving it back, it was like it's giving back to the crowd. So it's a batch process, right? The transaction cost for them was, it's very low. You get my point, right?
Yeah.
So these wallets, like does Venmo exist here? Venmo. So Venmo is a peer to peer transaction. Basically, you have something in your wallet and then you can transfer it to every, you'll have a list of all your friends and you can transfer to all your friends. I don't know the exact cost, but that sounds like something which, if that exists here, then it's probably worth looking at. So
when
we
start,
it's VNMO, Venmo. But this is something that your bank may be able to tell you what is the exact cost of transaction. So for example, if I want to make a, if I go to the bank and do an online transaction, they charge me $40, whether it is a $300 transaction or a $10,000 transaction. It's one shot, one time fee. So of course that doesn't make sense in your case, but because you want to send it to different people. But I would assume the financial institution that you're working with would have responsibilities.
And that there are companies with payment gateways which charge per month basis irrespective of the number of transactions that you do. And there are some services which charge based on the number of transactions that you do. There are services which charge based on the amount that you do. I think recently there's a news that Reliance is launching the POS service. Current POSs, on every swipe they charge something. Reliance, under 3,000 rupees, they don't charge anything. They want to charge only if the card or credit or debit swipe is over 3,000. So there are multiple policies based on which suits your business. I think you should choose.
It's an important question. But I don't have an answer. Any other questions?
Professor, I thought I would just recall. Have I been pawned.com is the one, I think.
Yes, that's the one.
Yeah.
So that you should probably write that down, because it's a very interesting website.
Have I been pawned?
Any other? Okay, thank you very much.
now request my fellow miracle Adarsh from PGDM 1 to deliver the vote of thanks.
I would like to thank Dr. Raghav Rao for coming here all the way from Texas and for delivering this long and, you know, very engaging session today. I would also like to thank the management of MYRA for organizing this session and for all the students who attended and for all the outsiders who've come here to experience what a session is like at the masterclass. I hope to have more such sessions and, sir, wish to have more interactions with you. Probably, you know, if you can tell us how we can get in touch with you after this session with any questions or how to stay up to date with the research findings, we would really like that. So once again, I thank all of you for being here and hope all of you enjoyed the session as much as I did, and hope all of you will take home something and research more on this and learn more. Thank you.
Available at the registration desk. I kindly request you to collect it. Thank you, everyone.